So now we're now going to move to Kath Dalmeny take it away.
It's funny looking out at this audience. It feels a bit like being at a wedding in that I am surrounded by people who I profoundly love and have had lots of arguments with. So I wanted to thank you, first of all, so many of you, friends old and new and yet to be, no doubt, for your companionship in this food policy journey, because we need to work together, and that's part of the joy of the food movement. I was reflecting with my husband that I'm as old as Friends of the Earth, so I don't need to tell you the date I was born, but you can go and look it up. But that also rather signals what one has to live with in this era, of the kind of knowledge we have to live with about the crises that are facing the system that sustains us. And I started my career in food policy following a conversation in a bar with Tim Lang. That was about 20 years or so ago. I was working at Schumacher College, so it was a bar that perhaps Aileen has visited as well. In fact, I probably made the bean stew that you ate that night. It's an international centre for ecological studies based in Devon on the Dartington estate, and Tim had come down to teach. And it was a sign of his generosity that he was as willing to extemporise and enthuse about food policy to the lady serving him in the bar as he was to the people on the course. So thank you for that. Because it was a wonderful conversation and it has shaped most of my life ever since. At the time, I was deliberately looking for a way to frame what I'd learned at Schumacher College as a member of staff in a way that could help me play some part in tackling the ecological challenges that Friends of the Earth had identified to me in my childhood, all of the challenges facing our species and our planet. I was about 25 then, and these were very highfalutin ideas that I'd heard in the college from people like James Lovelock, Fritjof Capra, I've really felt that I needed something to ground that, bring it back to the earth, bring it back to the soil, and what better subject than food. And food policy turns out to be that perfect framework to understand the web of interconnections, as you all know only so well, between ecological, economic, and social factors. As my lovely friend Carolyn, who's sitting there in the audience, says, food policy is a lens through which you can understand so many of the challenges facing us. And I started that Masters in Food Policy course nearly 20 years ago and ended up volunteering at the same time for the Food Commission, which Liz has mentioned, and for Sustain. And frankly, I've never looked back, which is ironic considering the title of our day today. And of course, we must always look back to our history, to the seeds of why we think and act in the way that we do, as well as upstream to the root causes of the problems, as you say, the socio and cultural determinants of the reason why people are hungry. And that's always to help us understand how to move forwards, otherwise we will repeat the problems that we have created. The Masters in Food Policy also provided a foundation for this kind of analytical way of thinking about our food system. It helped me understand how the institutions, structures, and economics of our culture shape what we eat and how it is produced. And so many people still don't get that. I'm sure you've all had conversations in which that is apparent, that people don't understand that. And more people need to be challenged to think like this in all of the ways that I know that you all do. And I wanted to use this platform to thank everyone from the Masters in Food Policy for starting me down the wonderful path of all those conversations about how we can reshape our institutions, structures, and economics to create the system that's fairer, healthier, keeps us all well-fed and within safe ecological limits. So what do I do now? I help to coordinate an alliance of about 100 civil society organisations who are all working on various aspects of that food system. I think they all do think systemically, but generally around particular issues which tend to coalesce their concerns into ways that they can fix things. I am now going to introduce my personal slide of the food system. This is a highly technical analysis. Obviously, I've labelled the axes on this graph, it's a very complicated metric works out. Actually, I've bunged some logos on to give you a sort of sense of how far I think we have progressed coming from a civil society perspective. So I decided to take iconic elements of the food system. If your issue is not represented here, sorry, Andrew, there's not a bread logo there. It does not mean I don't think it's important, it's just that it's quite a small slide. And food is gigantic as a subject, as you know. So the way I work and the way that Sustain as an alliance works is to take iconic elements of the food system and identify in groups, as Tim rightly said, we all work together. Nobody does this on their own. And we work out what things people think should be fixed. I'm trying not to use the word expert because Michael Gove told us we can't anymore. Can I say specialist? People who are really good at what they do. I'm surrounded by them. People who know stuff and have been thinking about it so well, for which I thank you all. You're all inspirational. So we bring together those people and organisations that are motivated to create change on that issue, and then we work step by step to try and make progress towards those shared goals, knowing that people will specialise in different elements of it. So I'm not trying to imply at all that by putting food waste and fish and heart health on the right-hand side of this slide that they've been fixed. Of course not. The metric of this slide is that the idea that if you're a bit further to the right, then more people get that there's a problem and therefore are seeking to do something about it. And the more to the left of the slide, I think, is where people have not quite got that there's an issue and that requires the governance, as David, as you said. So I rapidly improvised some more intelligent-sounding metrics as people were talking. The metrics are also to do with how much outrage people are feeling about the issue, how much moral anger. You quite rightly put emotions to this as well. How much outspokenness is there? How much of a case has been made for governance, as David said? Have critical actors identified their responsibilities within it? Whether they're being held to account, as he said. My lovely friend Peter, who's a lawyer, says, who can you sue, Kath? Who can you sue to make these things happen? Are people being held to account in this process? Have they been picked up by those people? Have they been picked up in different constituencies in a way that makes sense of those policies in action? For example, you mentioned, Terry, the Milan Urban Food Policy Pact. So has it made it onto those kind of agendas? Have we got the evidence for action? And is there an action plan in which people are actually going to do something about it? I was amused by your story about the action plan and Jeremy Metters, was it, who said, if we call it an action plan, we'll have to do something. Do you remember the Cabinet Office 2030 strategy for food policy? If you look at the front cover, I was always amused, it says towards a food strategy. It never actually made it. So we haven't quite made it to the right-hand side, have we? But looking at, say, a particular issue I'm obsessed about, apologies for this, but fish, for example, I've put it there as saying, has the world got it? Because I think people have got the idea that there is a crisis in fish stocks. 85 to 90% of the world's fish stocks are either fully exploited or in crisis. That's a pretty serious situation. There is no room for growth and expansion in the fish sector unless we take this more seriously. So there are well-worked-up policy responses to that now, like marine protection areas, which are beginning to blossom. There's a wonderful TED talk about somebody just showing a map of them starting to appear. So those policy responses enacted in actual areas of the sea where people can't fish to allow the little fish to do their business is... That's a highly technical analysis, once again. For little fish to fall in love is... That kind of policy is being enacted now. Not fast enough, not enough around the world, but it is there. Maximum sustainable yields are being implemented in fishing policy under threat from Brexit. We'll see what happens. And the consumption end of the fish bit is beginning to work. So caterers in the UK, you mentioned catering sector, very, very important. Corporate policies on sustainable procurement of fish are getting better. Nowhere near fixed yet. I'm not saying it's fixed by any means. This is not a naive slide. But I'm saying that do we get it as a species that we need to act? And are we beginning to act, I would say. So food waste, big one. Again, the moral case for action. Lots of people have now recognised that. Governments, institutions all over the world, businesses are picking up the idea that they need to take serious action on it. Unfortunately, as you point out, so much of it's being directed to the needy poor rather than looking at actually the causes of people's poverty. But again, that argument is beginning to be won, reframing it to talk about the evidenced intervention actions that could actually address inequalities rather than saying, here, eat these free chocolate biscuits or whatever it is we like to pass on. On bees have finally managed to make their case by not just buzzing but also telling us that they underpin the economics of our farming system. So recently, because unfortunately we've had to frame it, our movement has had to frame it as an economic benefit to have bees. Oh, how ghastly, but anything that will work. Bees are beginning to have policy to look at the pesticides, the diseases, the stocking densities, all kinds of things that affect bee health. as I say, it is unfortunate that that's had to be made in an entirely economic case. I laugh only because I heard an anecdote from a friend at Friends of the Earth who said that when he was in conversation with DEFRA, they'd made the case for the economic benefit of bees, putting a value on the ecosystem services that bees deliver. I know, how ghastly. If it helps them survive, let's do it. And apparently somebody at DEFRA said, could you tell us which of the bees are worth more, and then we can concentrate on those. Heaven help you if you're a cockroach, because you're not going to be able to prove your economic benefit. Fruit and veg is up there, but I've put it further down. Lots of people now recognise that we need to be increasing fruit and vegetable consumption, and a lovely image of the idea that children would be introduced to broccoli early enough for them to develop a lifelong taste. So I think we've got it, that's important, but we haven't got the structural stuff about why the horticulture industry is on its knees and will be absolutely destroyed by Brexit, as far as we can tell, partly because the age of cheap labour is no longer with us. So it's hovering somewhere. We get some of it, we don't get all of it. The money symbol is way to the left because that's all about inequalities. And of course, we haven't got that. I've never heard a truer word when you said that it goes in cycles. It feels like we're stuck in an eddy in a river, doesn't it? Round and round and round, going in circles. I think we took our eye off the ball under a Labour government thinking it was beginning to be fixed. And of course, we should remember that other people get elected, as this year has so amply proven. We're in the period of pantomime, you also said, which I thought was rather good. We've certainly got the wicked uncle in charge in America, haven't we? Success is patchy. And I've also put quite a lot of the environmental issues to the left, which is whether or not we totally understand that our sustenance relies entirely on the health of our ecosystem, I don't think has made it into policy in any substantial way. We do have a lot of environmental regulation, which is about fixing downstream problems of pollution and what comes out of the pipe of a car, but looking upstream at things like protection of soils, water quality in the first place, patchy at best. My little optimistic seedling there is also lingering towards the left, which is about farmers. Last week there were figures saying that farm incomes have gone down by a quarter. And you can hear the emotion in my voice. The idea that the people who are capable of creating our food are suffering, and largely in silence, unless they're joined up to the National Farmers Union, who were arguing mainly on the behalf of the larger farmers, it beggars belief. And all over the world, the statistics on the loss of farm livelihoods, the loss of farm incomes, the treatment by the concentration of power that Terry talks about needs fighting back against. And we will try and do our bit in sustain, and that's where movements need to be built to make sure that the right kind of farming gets retained, maintained, loved, cherished, that the consumption end rises to meet that challenge. So, yes, we've come a long way. I like, David, your summary. There's a lot to do and a lot to build on. So many of the people in this room have created some of the foundation stones for what we will build on for the future. And I also wanted to end on Tim's reasons to be cheerful. That's sounding like Ian Drury. Reasons to be cheerful. One, two, three. One is, I've just improvised these reasons to be cheerful. One is that Trump and Nigel Farage are temporary. The next one is we'll fix these things because we must. Since we created the problems as human beings, we can fix them. And the third one, because I'm feeling in reflective mood, because I've been invited to talk in this way, is that we are part of the tradition and movement. You showed some of the documents like this. You know, I was brought up on this stuff, and broccoli, luckily. And that this passing on of inspiration, Tim, thank you for everything that you've done to inspire over the years. Passing on of the inspiration and the stories, building up each other's courage, seeing one's place within the movement of each of these issues towards the right, I think is where we have to place our lives, particularly for the next 3 years during Brexit. I mean, it's thrown everything in the air, obviously. I hope it's an opportunity, David. Let's make it so. Thank you very much.
Indeed, there's an opportunity, so let's take it, let's make it. Thanks very much for that. Wonderful to hear how someone who is alumni of the Masters programme has come so very far and become so very influential yourself in taking this agenda forward. Thank you very much, Kath. Thank you. I would just like to, I'm going to go out to questions now. Just before we do that, I would really like to acknowledge the funders of this event who are sitting right here. Thank you so much for coming. Master Michael Thatcher. The clerk, Peter Wilkinson, of the Worshipful Company of Cooks. And I very much appreciate you coming. And I was sitting there feeling that you must be sitting there thinking, why aren't they talking about cooking? So I know that you care very much about that. I'm sure you weren't thinking that, but I know that you care about that a great deal. And I think it's one of those things that when you're in a room such as this, with the people in this room such as this, we all deeply care about cooking, and it's almost that's just kind of accepted that we all care. We really know how important that is at an individual level, and so many of us are so passionate about food and cooking, and of course most of the people in the world are not, and that's the real challenge. That's the real agenda that we've heard, the agenda that we need to be taking forward into the future. So enough from me. I would like to ask you to ask questions of the panel. Tim, would you care to join the panel? If you can squeeze a chair in. We have half an hour. And what I want to hear from you is some challenges, your own perspectives. This afternoon, we'll be moving much more into the voices of the audience. But some specific questions, but ask them hard questions. They're really clever people. You can ask them hard questions that are going to make all of us in the room think even harder about what we need to be doing to go forward into the future. So I'm going to pass the microphone to my colleagues here, but can someone raise their hand, please?
Hello, my name is Tom Lyons. I'm a freelance consultant. I was delighted to hear Liz Dalmeny speak just now. What she said is absolutely right. Is that better?
Yeah.
Maybe I should just speak up. Without farmers to grow it, there's no food for the rest of us to eat. So that's absolutely central to the whole food nexus. And I'd like to ask how we can reconcile this question with what Harry Marsden said about the end of cheap food. Because where I come into this picture is looking at prices, and I do not see the end of cheap food. Quite the contrary. Food is cheaper as it leaves the farm than it has ever been in real terms. I absolutely agree that what happened between 2007 and 2011, what it actually represented was a crisis of the so-called conventional form of agriculture. What form did this take, though? In economic terms, it was the fact that the input prices of fuels and chemicals, which farmers using that method have to pay, have gone up faster than the prices of their outputs over a long period. And that is in line with all sorts of other long-term trends. And that is why we have this problem. Food prices are, in real terms, the lowest there's ever been, which is, again, a continuation of a very, very long-term trend. It may reverse itself because of the climate change and other environmental problems. It may have already done so, perhaps, in some parts of the world, but not in temperate countries like this. But what we also have, most importantly and most seriously, is cheap farmers. And that is why people, even sons and daughters of farmers all over the world, are not going into agriculture. And the farming population is, you know, is getting older and older and will soon be dying out if we do not do something now about stabilizing and, above all, increasing farm gate food prices.
I was going to
This is Rebecca Lawton from the Land Workers Alliance. I was also going to pick up on the issue of cheap food, cheap environment and cheap labour and it coming to an end. And as a small-scale organic producer, I was really pleased to hear you think that. But likewise, I can't quite see how it's going to happen, because without a dramatic increase in everyone's livelihoods so that they can pay for the more expensive food, I can't see how it's going to happen. So I just wanted to ask for more thoughts on that particular conundrum.
Hello, I'm Catherine Fuchs from the Organic Trade Board. Previously worked at Sustain and very interested in all food issues. And the question I want to ask is, how do we take what you have to now see as an opportunity of Brexit to build a movement? Because I don't think we can get any of the changes we want without building a movement of people to change the food system. Now, to me, the biggest areas where we might have some engagement with consumers and some interest is around, one, food prices, which everyone's already mentioned, and two, the countryside, and the fact that if people want to go and visit the countryside and see it as it is in the UK, then we need to do something about the food system. So those are my two, but I'd really be interested to know what the panel thinks, the one or two things that we can try and build a movement around, get the message out there to consumers to join with us to make a better food system. Otherwise, we're just not going to succeed.
Thank you. I do have some more questions, but I'd like to go back to the panel and ask not all of you, but a couple of you to respond to those questions. Then we'll go out to questions and come back again. So, Terry, would you like to respond?
Yeah, I I realise it's easy to say about the end of cheap food, cheap labour and cheap ecology, and not easy to rebuild. But I mean, that seems to me what we've got to start doing, and rebuilding the food system by making it a more diverse system, it seems to me. This is where Brexit, the debate about Brexit, should come in, because I agree completely with the issue of the centrality of farmers, not least small farmers, in this process. And we've been losing them at a great rate of knots, as we know. We're losing five a week or something as we talk. So solve that problem. Well, one issue is we have to realise that we've got, in a sense, relatively expensive food at one end of the spectrum in terms for consumers, and relatively strong input costs for farmers at the other. So neither end is benefiting in the current conventional system. So what we need to do, it seems to me, is build new infrastructures and more diverse infrastructures to build alliances between groups of consumers and groups of producers, short-circuiting existing value captured chains, which take the value out at the middle in that sense. So we need a more diversity of production and consumption linkages, and this is where I think international comparisons with solidarity consumer group movements in many parts of the South, collaborative, much more collaborative and cooperative structures amongst producers as well, which can be stimulated actually by policy and by government. Just that government doesn't really want to do that currently. It tries to see farmers as basically neoliberal individuals and expecting them to operate as individuals, where we need to rebuild new forms of collective organisation, cooperative organisations, around producers and consumers and link them together. So this is where innovation in our thinking needs to come about, I think, in this debate that we're going to have. Now, one of the constraints in this debate is the conservatism, in many cases, of the representative groups of some of the farm producers, particularly the NFU, for instance, which is arguing for the continued devaluation of labour, it seems to me, and in many respects, the marginalisation of many of its small farmers. So, in a sense, I think we have to try to build new alliances with producer groups and bring them into the fold about food policy, where in many cases they've been somewhat detached from that debate in this sense, in a sense that they may see themselves as somewhat outside of the discussion about food consumption and certainly about food and environment issues. So they feel themselves isolated and embattled with environmental and often food consumer issues. So somehow we have to build alliances which bring consumer representative groups and producer representative groups back together again. And that's a real big challenge for us.
Thank you very much. Kath and Tim?
I'm going to try and answer Rebecca, Tom and Catherine all at once. Hey, here we go. I totally agree with you. That's my opening point, in that the basis of all of this has to be a thriving farming sector that is being paid well and enjoying the better share of the value that goes through the supply chain. And that might entail breaking up the concentration of the supermarkets, probably will. It might involve taking some serious legal cases as well. Having watched the Uber case, for example, you know this thing about Uber being classed as employing the taxi drivers that it's, gosh, you can show I'm quite old. You know, these app things on these modern phones that you can book a taxi cab through an app. It strikes me that farmers have never been treated as employees of the supermarkets, yet they are totally bound to them by contractually, that they don't receive holiday pay, maternity pay, sick pay, you know, all the things that we would enjoy as employees, you know, that there may be legal cases to be taken. And maybe, Tom, we should have a conversation since you're nodding. It strikes me we have to get more feisty and more angry because it's ridiculous. Some of the opportunity to build those alliances and movements, Catherine, may come from the public money for public goods discourse that will be happening around Brexit, because I think his recognition now that we shouldn't be paying people just for having some land, but that we should be paying that for something that we want in return. Well, obviously, food, yes, of course, ecosystem services, if we must, but better, looking after our precious true assets of soil, water, air, etc. But also to helping people make the transition in farming to better ways of doing things in a way that we would all like, for example, less antibiotic reliance in livestock farming. So there's some really seriously good stuff that could be won by working in building movements around that. And I'd say that the movements are nascent already, so we need to find them and stoke them as hard as possible. So there's some fantastic work going on organised by Tradecraft around the groceries code adjudicator, trying to get the groceries code adjudicator that is looking at the effects of the concentration of power to tackle that the abuses of power that happen in the supply chain. So that's on behalf of farmers in the UK, but also overseas, because Tradecraft is involved. Fantastic coalition that involves NFU and Tradecraft in the same room. How interesting, new alliances. There's a better food traders movement nascent at the moment. People who are interested in saying, actually, there's a representative here who just nodded, absolutely, to try and say, okay, what if we did retail in a way where farmers mattered? Let's make sure that they do get the value in the supply chain. Again, really small, but fanning the flames over the last 20 years has meant that there are big successes in some of the issues that we care about. The new infrastructures, the short-circuiting of the systems that make it work. There are a few of those that Sustain is working on, so if you're interested in those, please talk to me after this or get in touch.
Okay.
Be part of it.
Thank you, Kath. You're going to pass. David?
So there is sort of an alternative out there, which is what's happening at the corporate end, I think, we need to be aware of as well, and that is that while we might see a reduction in farmers, we're not necessarily seeing a reduction in farming in the UK. And that's because we're getting a much more corporate farming system and agricultural production system. If you look at cheap labour, the way to get rid of cheap labour is get rid of labour. So the Amazon model, which they're trialling in the States at the moment in their own stores, which of course they've already ruthlessly exploited the supply chains, and we also see that with robotics as well. So I was at a meeting of all the major commodity growers in vegetables in the UK recently, a closed door meeting. And what they're looking for is the transition. Their socio-technical transition is to robotics and automation. And that's seen as innovation. It's seen as sponsoring economic growth. It fits into prevailing government agendas at the moment. So there is an alternative out there which is in the governance sense, being identified. The problems and solutions are being formulated. So we need to think about that and how we're going to challenge that. And would we rather have less labor rather than exploited labor in the food system? Maybe we would. So we need to think about those things, I think. I think there are, you know, interestingly, I've actually just waiting to hear on TED Talks this week about an EU bid where I'm on food value chains, where I've got both the British Retail Consortium and Tradecraft as stakeholders who've written support for it, because we're looking, you know, part of the aim of it is to try and get a more equitable food value chain system for producers throughout Europe. But we do need to be aware of those alternatives, and that's kind of what I was saying, I think, at the end of my 5 minutes this morning. Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay, one answer to Catherine's question. I'm not sure there are two issues that unite, and that's the problem. Actually, it's a problem, but it's a strength, and that's also what I was saying earlier, that actually we've got quite a wide coalition of specific interests who are the progressive voices in food policy. They run from animal welfare to natural resource sustainability to child poverty. You know, that's a strength, and, you know, Sustain is an embodiment of that, actually, as it's an alliance of 100 members. I'm on a trustee of Sustain also. So I think that is a strength, but on the other hand, it can be a weakness, because it's how do you keep that united and galvanized. What you get is more episodic involvement by those particular interests on particular issues within food policy, I think.
Thank you. Okay, more questions. Jeff, and then Sharon.
Thanks, Jeff Tansey. A pessimistic question followed hopefully by a more optimistic one. Picking up on what you said, David, I think some of us here were at the meeting with Susan George in 1976. Two things she said: look, study the rich and powerful, and two, the system's working, because it's about concentrating wealth and power, which it's doing quite well. And I think that goes to the point David made. We need a much better understanding of the development of financialization and how the system has a solution that we don't like, maybe, because it is sustainability in the way we think of it doesn't matter that much. We're clever enough to get our way out of some of this stuff. We're going to automate. And I think we need to understand that much better, and more work needs to go on helping people see where it's going in the direction that David was talking about, because I think it may be that people might not like that so much. Secondly, how are you and the rest of us here going to get engaged with some of the follow-up to the Fabian Commission on Food and Poverty? There's a large, attempted to be large, End Hunger UK campaign to link the 40,000 plus people who are so angry that people go hungry in Britain that they give their time to create and support people to get fed. Now, there's a lot of issues around food banks, but this is a campaign about involving them in the conversation, getting them involved and understanding some of the dynamics we've got, and making that part of a bigger movement in towards the changing post-Brexit policy, but also government. So there's work on household food insecurity as well, and getting that measured so we know who's actually insecure in Britain, how we're making progress. So I hope there's work that we can link in with that's going on. Church Action on Poverty is leading one of that, and the Food Foundation on another. And there are resources that we can draw on, which I hope people will be able to use. Food Systems Academy, Food Research Collaboration.
Thank you. Tony Allen from King's College. Thank you very much for the contributions. As usual, I felt they were politically light, in that this is a really elemental issue that's so important that politicians over the decades, centuries, have made it that it's a background issue which you never relate to. It's more important than the things that get high on the political agenda, such as the health service and other things that are in the top 10. In fact, food prices are so important they can't even get in. And as I have been saying since 2010 or 11, you know, that this is a price spike. It's going to go down. Many commodities are at 2003 prices now. And all the experiment has done is prove to the traders that there is enough capacity in there, that if the prices go up, farmers will produce. So we have, in fact, a combination of politicians absolutely needing to have underpriced food for underpaid people. I'm pleased that that theme is coming through. It is the underpaid people that need to be provided with cheap, underpriced food. And that's been raised a few times. And I loved the intervention of the first intervention, because I was making notes. It wasn't the number of times farm and farming was mentioned was negligible. Farming is the issue. We need, as consumers, to eat sensibly and not waste food. We need our own good health, but we obviously, in having choice, don't necessarily do that. But as voters, if we live in a democracy, we've got to give the politicians political space to do what is necessary to make sure that the farmers can manage the environment. I'm interested in the 92% of water which is managed and consumed by farmers, 92% plus or minus some error bar, that farmers manage for us. We need to be sure that they have the capacity to do that well and sensibly. And as someone once said, going green is difficult when you're in the red. So we need our farmers to be capable of doing what we need them to do. But politics, please, we want it right out in front. We need to vote so that politicians have the political space to make sure that we have affordable food for everyone and not cheap food.
Thank you.
My name's Sharon Noonan Gunning. I'm a PhD student with Tim and Martin. And I'm also a children's dietitian specialising in child health management for a number of years. And I just wanted to ask a question about the political context that when Tim spoke, he was talking about shifts in the political context and where we are now. And the bulk of my PhD has been doing interviews with working class mothers who have got very overweight children, and it's their views on where food policy should be going and what should be happening. And one of the big areas that they touched upon, for example, was fast food outlets and what's happening in their communities. And really what this led me to as I was sort of thinking through what's happening is how has food policy been used as an oppressive tool on people? Because on the one hand, you know, Liz was talking about the morality of what goes on and the immorality of the government that knows what they're doing, and that often we know what policy is doing, but what we forget is that the people that it's happening to, the policy recipients, the working class, poor working class parents, are the ones who know it's happening to them. And so they're not stupid, they know it's happening. And that's what came through some of my research, was that, you know, when we use words, you know, not swearing words, but the words that people use to describe what's happening in their lives, is because they live it every single day. And it isn't just a case of saying, oh, I wish it could be a bit nicer. It's because they know when they go outside of their doors and the only food that their children have got access to is fast food outlets, is that it shapes the way they think. And so, for example, I had a 23-year-old young mum who said that, and there's, you know, quite a few examples of where parents did describe how you can't think. And you can't think, it's not just because of your work and your precarity or zero-hour contracts in which you can't feed your children on routine hours anyway, let alone cook, but you can't, when you go outside your door, all you see is a mass of fast food. And the words that the parents used were things like that they know they're putting quick food out there for us now. They know what's happening in their communities and they have no control over it. And so for me, that then becomes that policy becomes an oppressive tool, and food policy. Councillors say, oh, it's planning and not food policy, it's all about planning. But it isn't. It is about, you know, where, in the end, if the food gets produced, it gets out there and it does get dumped on people. And people who it gets dumped upon knows it gets dumped upon them, on their children. Their children get sick, they know it. And so I just think through the shifts that are taking place in the Brexit vote and all of that, then where does food, I just think there has to be a different articulation of food policy about it, how it's more emancipatory, how it's not, you know, I just think maybe we need to think about the people who it's actually affecting, you know, and shifts that are taking place there. Because if Brexit was partly, there was an expression of food within Brexit, and it was about the foodscapes, and it was about the violence that people face every single day when they go and they see a fast food shop by their kids' school, when they see it by the bus stops. And so it's just, so that's just one example, but that's the point really, is there's, you know, political shifts that are taking place. Is there what's happening amongst the working class, and how can we bring that into food policy around practically what they eat? Because they know it's happening, they know, they're not stupid.
Thank you. We'll take a couple more questions, then go back to the panel, then we'll have to end. Thanks for that point. I will go up to the back there.
Yeah, Alan Holsworth, a quick point following on from what Kath said. which is that the grocery code process is under review right now, and please get some views in, because I was at the meeting 2 weeks ago, and the dominant thing was, we are economists, we want quantitative evidence from the public, and they're not going to get any, because the public has absolutely no quantitative evidence. So we have to get in there and make sure that Christine Taken gets the backing to do more good work.
Yeah. 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 Could I just make a quick response to that? I think one of the key things there is actually what the legal remit is. So we need to look very carefully at what the leak, because they are doing very good work, Christine Taken and her team, but it's quite clear that it's restricted exactly to what the legal remit is. So that's where we need to look for expansion on that.
Okay. Hello, my name's John Alexander. I'm a trustee of the Food Ethics Council and also run a consultancy working on food at the moment. I guess I'm interested in chipping into this food poverty conversation as well, but I'm particularly interested in whether any of the panel have come across or tapped into some of the conversations about universal basic income as a broader policy idea and any reflections on what role that might have as an intervention in the food system.
Thank you very much. Universal basic income. Haven't we flooded with questions now? There was some at the back there who have been waiting for a while.
Thank you. Caroline Seaman, Norfolk. I've been immensely cross and frustrated about food scenarios for a very long time. As a farmer's daughter, I have to make the observation when we talk about farming, and it's great to hear somebody acknowledge that farmers are an important part of our landscape. A lot of farmers, of course, are not producing food that goes immediately into the food system. And I think that's really important for a lot of people outside farming to understand. There is also a lot of pressure on farmers to consider using their land for the production of biofuels and for solar farms and for housing developments in order to house people where urban planners have been unable to make satisfactory use of their own brownfield sites and have to go out to the countryside. That aside, I have a background in public health, nutrition and hospitality. I am delighted to hear some enthusiasm for antenatal nutrition, which anybody who follows me on Twitter will know has been my big thing for a long time. How are we going to call midwifery to account? Apologies if there are midwives in the room, but I've had a long battle for a long time about who has the duty of care of young parents who frequently have not benefited from positive food experiences through their own contextual norms within their communities, where things have been going on for many generations, where we have high rates of teenage pregnancies resulting in very rapid generation turnaround, where we know from smoking cessation, we have an opportunistic way to support in a practical fashion, no more of the many leaflets and advice and information which doesn't take into account that these have young people who frequently don't even know what sort of peeler they are going to find most useful, to embed good weaning practice during a period while baby is in womb to improve nutrition, and then at the other side not wait until health visitors take the role of responsibility and duty of care beyond the end of life of satisfactory breastfeeding uptake. When we then wait until a weaning workshop, where as a specialist food practitioner for many years, I heard regularly, why didn't someone teach me to do this before my fucking baby was born? Quote, directly. But how are we going to pull midwifery to account? How do we pull the key players at a top level to actually get on board with producing the sort of systemic solutions that operate at an individual level, because that is not happening and it hasn't happened for a very long time.
Thank you. Very powerful points being made here. I'm conscious of...
You better take this away from me, I've still got it.
...of time moving on. But I do want to give people a voice, because I can see that there are people really wanting to speak and share their perspective. I think there were a couple of further questions which I had a bit overlooked until now, and one of them was here and one of them was there. Thank you.
Hi, Catherine Arnold, studying water science policy and management at Oxford. So my question ties in a bit with the alternative use for agricultural land, specifically in the context of policies to combat climate change, so biofuel and BECCS negative emissions schemes. I want to ask the panel, what do you think the implications for food security and policy are of such schemes? Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, one last question. I apologise to those who've been waiting to speak. Okay, I'll have two more, one and two, because you've been waiting a long time. It's important. Yeah, sorry, it's here. I know that you're not going to be able to respond to all of these, but I think it's important to hear the perspective of the audience.
Hi, Carolyn Steele, author of a book called Hungry City, and I will try to keep this brief, but food is the most valuable thing in our lives. So the very idea of cheap food is an oxymoron. Terry spoke about neoliberalism and the fact that really what we're seeing is the sort of the breakdown of that logic. To try to summarise a whole load of things very, very briefly, what does the I'm going to fail, aren't I? But what does the panel think of the idea of what I would call Sitopian economics? Sitopia is a word I invented. It just means food place. But it recognises the fact that everything in our lives is shaped through food. The principle of this would simply be to internalise the true costs of food. And I'm thinking through this for myself at the moment. I think it's completely revolutionary, but it could also be incremental. So obviously, if one really were to do this, then industrial food would become completely unaffordable, which would put half the population in a position of not being able to afford it, which would then necessitate a sort of reallocation of resources so that we had a more equal society and so on. So it's really turning the whole logic upside down and saying, let's drive our thinking and our economics from the social contract, if you like, that everybody deserves to eat well. So it's turning, and while I've still got the mic, I would just like to say that Tim Lang is the most incredible inspiration, and I've been tearing up for the last 2 hours too. So thank you for everything.
Thank you, Carolyn. Thank you very much.
So are the other members of the panel, by the way.
One final question, yes.
I'm Katie Cooper from C3 Collaborating for Health and shortly to be an independent consultant. That was a fascinating panel. Thank you so much. I can't remember the last time I was at a conference where I've so enjoyed a conversation. Liz, thank you for mentioning human rights. This is an absolutely fundamental human rights issue. It's not just about the right to food. It's about the right to the best attainable standard of health. It's an education issue. But I do feel that there's a lot of cynicism and a huge amount of lack of understanding about what human rights mean, especially potentially in a post-Brexit world. I think that was part of the rationale for Brexit. And I was wondering if the panel could say something about, is the human rights approach to food something that you come across in your work, something that you use? And do you think that focusing more on it in the future would help our case or hinder it, given the current situation?
Thank you. Wow, what an incredible, amazing range of questions. I was absolutely gripped by everything that you had to offer. Really, really fascinating. Challenging for you. It is now 10 minutes after we're due to go to lunch. We can carry on for a bit longer. So could I ask actually just to go through the panel and ask you to self-select some specific questions to answer, respecting the fact that we had a wide range of questions and it would be good to have most of them touched upon. Tim, I'll start with you and just go straight through into David.
Okay. Me too. They were really good comments. I mean, this is a permanent debate, as we know. But I'm really pleased the issue of money has come up because, the crucial issue is who gets the money. That's the issue. Farming has been squeezed and is squeezed. But what's happened is over the last 100 years, supply chains have lengthened and got longer, and everyone takes more money. I mean, if you look at the British figures, farming gets £9.6 billion value added out of £201 billion that the British consumer spends. It's squeezed, squeezed, squeezed. And I think there is actually very fertile territory for a radical food policy analysis on this. But my but is we must not just focus on farming. My hero and friend Tony Allen, the guru of water, is always berating me on this issue. But Tony, the food system has expanded and got really, really long. Where you're absolutely right is farming is the biggest employer on the planet. It's 1.5 billion people are employed, as I said in my talk, 500 million with no wages. But actually, in the rich world, the supply chain has lengthened. And now, in a country like Britain, catering is 1.7 million people employed. Farming is only 460,000. The responsibility of the farmers is huge, but actually caterers are, I mean, I was really glad Terry raised that because it's very dear to Martin's and my heart as what we've tried to do in the centre. And it's how we got the relationship with the Worshipful Company of Cooks. And I too echo my thanks. Peter Varsatnall Wilkinson is here, the clerk, and they've just been fantastic. They backed us right from the beginning when we came to City. It was really wonderful. This is one of the ancient City livery companies. It's a charity, so it's been very good. But I think we need to focus more on that lengthening of the supply chain and the role of catering. Chefs as culture change is something we've celebrated through the Jamie Olivers and Hugh Fernley Whittingstalls and so on. But actually, we've got to root that much better, I think. And the role of cooking and culture change is something I think we're only just beginning on. On the human rights, I'm just rereading something I read a long time ago. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the year I was born, 1948, a good year. H.G. Wells wrote the piece that led to it in 1940. And it's really interesting. You cannot deal with everything we've been talking about and everything the wonderful panelists talked about without having a notion of rights. But the problem with the notion of rights, I have always had big arguments and fallen out with some of my friends on this, there's danger if we think rights are somehow up there. It's got to be built into culture. If it's not built into culture, people's everyday expectations, we're lost. People expect clean air. That's, I mean, to say it's a right, it wasn't assumed. You know, the 1848 Public Health Act, the Clean Air Act of 1956, the Food Safety Act of 2000, these altered the terrain. They took a lot of getting. And what we're now, I think, talking about, and Kath and I have been talking, and others, I think we're in the position now where we need to be talking about a new food act, a really big panoramic to bring together all of the things that the panel, and indeed I, through my fog, was trying to talk about. Why? Because Brexit loosens everything. And let me tell you, as someone who works on Brexit, the Great Repeal Bill, which was 4 pages, it's a lot bigger now. It's a lot bigger now. And DEFRA and others are telling me across the Whitehall machine they now know they've got to have a supplementary piece of legislation to deal with food. 40% of all EU legislation is food. You can't just include this through the Great Repeal Bill. So moments of opportunities to take rights and build them into expectations. This notion of rights is very loose and too big. If you read people like H.G. Wells, they're talking about culture change. They're talking about what can people expect to have in their daily lives. No one wants to have dirt if they've got used to cleanliness. And what we've got to do is start trying to think about that through the lens of food. But my final point is I really do think this argument about the squeeze on farming, we need more studies, Terry. This is, you and I have failed on this. We need to work harder, obviously. We need more studies, better analysis of where the money goes. Because consumers are actually spending a lot of money on food, but where it goes doesn't end up at the primary producer, but the value adding that goes on is immense, and it varies enormously in different sectors and different circumstances. So this is an area I think we've got to get really wised up on.
Okay, Liz. Thanks. Yeah. We're all sitting here not expecting anybody to light a cigarette while we're sitting here in this room. I'm not speaking about cigarettes per se. I'm just saying that something which would have been unimaginable when I started out, sorry we're all talking about past, but anyway, it's partly the nature of the day, is now unimaginable in the opposite way. And it's somehow capturing what is it we want to be unimaginable in the future, as it were, and making it happen and starting that conversation with everybody. And to answer, I think John Alexander raised an important point at the back about basic income. There are lots of conversations going back on, knocking around on that idea. Citizens' income, it was called when I first came across it, and it has various sort of forms. When I was at a meeting on household food security in Toronto a couple of weeks ago, there were people there talking about it quite widely. On the rights front, I think those things link in, also with your Sitopian economics, which you need to get a better word. But anyway, what it seems to me what all those things are about is thinking about something in a completely different way. The word rights to this, that, and the other has a very bad, has a mixed, shall we say, reception at the moment in Britain, or parts of Britain. As I indicated, there is quite a movement and some progress at legislative level in Scotland towards the right to food. And I also have had very similar conversations with people in Ireland, in the Isle of Ireland, and elsewhere. I mean, this is not new here. On the contrary, it's very slow here. But as we know, for anybody who's lived or has been here over the last year and listened to the conversations on media generally, read stuff, you will know that human rights has been a rather kind of no-no stuff. So I'm not for one minute suggesting that the language needs to be changed, but it's the ideas need to be got across in a better way. One of the key things about the right to food is it's justiciable, that it's not something for which you have to go and beg. It's not something that you have to make, for which you have to make a case. It's something which is yours by virtue of being a citizen. Ah, there's a problem. What about people who are not a citizen? So immediately it raises more issues. However, you asked the question, had I any experience, or had anybody on the panel experience in looking at this? I have some, but I would point people, if they're interested in this, to the work, building on what Jeff Tansey said, the work that Church Action on Poverty has been doing for the last couple of years. They produced a film where people are talking about the right to food and what a difference that makes to them in their thinking. And that those sets of conversations have been going on in different places. And I suspect, I hope, that's something that's going to be picked up this afternoon. If we want to think about, by virtue of being a citizen here, you have a basic income which comes to you by right, on which you can build by working or by other means, that is a completely different way of thinking about life. And it's not just something you change and nibble away at and have conversations about minimum income. It's a completely different way of thinking about how the world works. And I feel, and I know John shares this view, and I think many in the room shares the room, in all this kind of life shock moment that we've been living through in 2016 for all sorts of reasons, and maybe longer than that, this is the opportunity to begin those conversations very urgently and to enable them not just to be private conversations, but conversations which build and move out. I want to put in a final plug for the Oxford Real Farming Conference, which happens at the beginning of January. Doesn't cost a huge amount, takes place in Oxford, funnily enough, and is very much trying to look at radical solutions across the food system. And certainly in the past, there have been conversations there about rights and citizens' income. I don't know if there are this year, because I haven't studied the programme. And I'm going to stop there.
We're doing a session. It's £35, by the way, for a day.
I'll try and be very brief. Midwives, absolutely. Let's write a wish list of who you'd like in a room in 2017 and get them around and talk about it. Let's be bold and fix some things. Biofuels you talked about. I think biofuel, the use of grade one agricultural land for biofuels and solar panels is bonkers, particularly in a world in which we are also needing it to grow food and rewild it and all sorts of things that we would like from land. Bonkers. So we need to do something about resisting that move. But in the same context, we should be feeding animals more grass and food waste and less grain for the same sorts of reasons. Human rights, I think you've covered it brilliantly, so I'll leave that. But just to say, it's a very interesting approach. It's part of the basket of policy measures to create the safety net, as you say, to create the sense of culture of how we approach all of these things. And changing the conditions, absolutely. And there is some good work, as you said, in Scotland, but also with the Agricultural Wages Board, which is about setting some baselines around, below which people should not be able to fall. In terms of Sitopia, if there is a bar in Sitopia, I'd like to spend the rest of existence there with you. Yeah, I'm done.
Okay, thanks. I'll mainly just deal with the health sector aspect, and I wouldn't only leave it at midwives, I would actually deal it with that whole kind of sector, dealing with women's health. And I think this brings me back to the gender issue in food, and I think maybe we need to bring the aspect of gender and food higher up, because maybe in terms of the rights agenda and the gender equality, I think that's being listened to more within Europe. And I don't know if you're all aware that there is a gender equality index score now. And each country has it, and it's based on six metrics. And these metrics are then added up. And we've actually just finished a review for the European Parliament, believe it or not, who are now interested in this issue. And we found a very clear correlation between the gender index scores and poor maternal and child health. So I think that's one of the routes that we should go through. The reason I'm very concerned about the midwives and the whole obstetrics and all that issue is because if we say we've got a lack of it, we'll just end up getting more of what we've got, and that means the situation is going to be even worse because they are the problem. So I think we have to go around it more from the gender point of view and more from community upwards. Part of this review that we've put in, the European Parliament wants a recommendation how to take it forward to reduce inequalities, and it'll be particularly through the first 1,000 days. And some of the issues that seem to be coming out are maybe peer-to-peer support, looking more at what's happening in developing countries with community health volunteers. It has to be away from health professionals because they simply make the situation worse. I think getting back to the point, women with young children know what to do, and so they definitely need the support. And that gets back to the whole issue of, you know, why didn't somebody tell me about this earlier? And also about the cooking skills that they need. And it gets back to, again, my biodiversity, which, by the way, when I mention the biodiversity, I'm also a farmer's daughter. But I think we should be very careful when we think about farmers as a generic kind of item, because I think we don't want necessarily more meat and milk production, whereas I think that a lot of people associate farming with agriculture.
And horticulture.
Yeah, exactly. Tim, you always don't let me. Yeah, you. Always, now he's doing it again. He's still doing it. Shut up, Tim. So it has to be horticulture, and I think we have to say horticulture and biodiversity a bit louder. Okay, thanks.
Quickly, people want some lunch, I'm sure. Many of the comments were very interesting because they were sort of taking a reality check on what we'd said as panellists, I thought, and really also indicating that things are going in the opposite direction, right? Yeah, they are going in the opposite direction. So the issue here is about restorative food systems. It's about how we restore food systems, not just about making them sustainable, but actually restoring a lot of their values. Let me give you three pragmatic areas, which I think are important to progress responding to some of the comments. One of them, it seems to me, is the potentially powerful link, which I think Aileen pointed to, particularly between biodiversity, nutritional diversity, and the type of farming systems we have. It seems to me that's really a powerful issue here, not least in terms of expanding agroecology and all other forms of diverse farming systems to nutritionally enhance and restore, and to biodiversity enhance and restore. And making those critical links, I think, is politically potentially very powerful. The second area, and this is all about the economy, isn't it? It's all about the economy in the sense that the climate change agenda is not really going to go away here, and we're going to have to come off the carbon-based system. So we're going to have to change farming systems, and we can use that agenda, it seems to me, very powerfully for making transitions in farming and food systems much more effectively than we have. And it's, you know, one response is, okay, more precision farming, more genetics, and so on. But there's an alternative to that, which I think which we need to look at. There's an increasing literature out there that investors are moving away from carbon-based investments in this context. So what sort of things are they going to be investing in? Is a good question. A third area is in what's happening in terms of our cities. And a lot of work's been being done by colleagues and so on around city-based initiatives. And it seems to me this is another area where we can link forms of urban gardening and horticulture, but also to cuisine, cooking, and training, and skills development in terms of meeting the needs of the poor in many of our cities. And I think Brazil has got a lot of very interesting examples from which we can draw on here, where sustainable composting systems are developing in the most poorest of areas, and dealing with the high costs of waste that are being created, and recycling that through the circular economy. So I think the economy needs to be addressed full on here and work out ways in which we can get better outcomes.
Right, thank you. All those points that were made earlier, I think, are all very important and quite significant as well. I won't try to address them. The issue about rights, I've just mentioned that, of course, going back to the 80s, the Reagan-Thatcherite era, with rights came a new agenda of obligation, and from that obligation came forms of governance, which we've been decrying, actually, around food poverty and the identification of people eating wrong and not being able to manage their households and so forth. So one has to be very careful, I think, embarking on that. I am fully aware, however, that I am between you and your right to lunch, but you know what they say, there's no such thing as a free lunch. What I would just like to finish on from a governance perspective is this question of discourse and debate and dialogue. And I'd just like to pay tribute, because I forgot to do it in my first chance of speaking, to the alumni of the Masters in Food Policy over the last 18 years, both the alumni of the Masters in Food Policy, the current food policy students, many of whom I don't know, but I'm sure they're continuing in the same vein, and also the doctoral students and researchers as well have worked in the Centre for Food Policy, because you're part of the network of what Tim has called the next generation of food terrorists. Long may you create havoc. Thank you.